Praise God. Let the people of God say amen, amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a weekly Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we exalt, we edify, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. And before we go into anything today, I want to wish you a very merry, merry Christmas in the name of Jesus from this program and from Eternal Food Ministry. Thank you for tuning in every week to watch us and listen to the Word of God. Because people don't like to listen to the real Word of God that will challenge them. But we thank God for your life that you are tuning in every week. The Lord bless you, and it's our prayer that all the sermons that you have listened to over the months in this year, they will do the work that they are supposed to do in your life, in Jesus' name. Today, we are going to be learning from the shepherds. So the title is Lessons from the Shepherds. Remember, we are doing a Christmas series that we started, I believe, about 3 weeks ago. We started with Jesus as a case study under the title A Successful Spiritual Personality. And then we followed that with Mary as the case study under the title In a Free World. And last week, we did How to Be God's Instrument of Greatness using Joseph, the fiancé or the husband of Mary, as a case study. So today, we are going to be using the shepherds as a case study. And the title or the topic is Lessons from the Shepherds. But before we do anything, let us pray. Father, we thank you. You are so beautiful. Thank you, Father, for you love the world so you sent your only begotten Son to deliver us from the grip of the devil, from the prison of sin. Father, let your word come to our hearts through this program. Break every fallow ground, O Lord, and let our hearts become good soil where the seed of your word will enter, germinate, and prosper in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. All right. The short reading, remember we started it when the Holy Spirit said we should be doing that. The short reading for this week is going to be a gospel according to St. Luke chapter 2. We are going to start from verse 8 to 17. That is your homework. And yes, I've read it, okay? Luke 2, 8 to 17. But our foundation text is going to be the book of Psalm, chapter 1. We are going to read verses 1 to 2. The book of Psalms, we are going to read the first chapter, verse 1, and we stop at 2. Blessed is the man of the woman who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he or she meditates day and night. Our senior pastor, he always says, we all need to learn this by heart, know it on top of our heads. So what lessons can we learn from the shepherds? Number one, they were diligent watchers. The shepherds were diligent in keeping company, listen up please, with like commoners who had no social or economic standing. If you were a shepherd in the time of Jesus, listen. The only class below you as a shepherd were the lepers. Shepherds had no standing whatsoever. So bad, their witnesses, if they witnessed anything, it was not even admissible in the court in ancient times. They were despised, okay? So they looked for like people. They weren't trying to go out of their social class or economic class. They were comrades by their lowly, lonely occupation. And it's lonely because during the day, one shepherd will travel with his few sheep around the country area. But at night, the shepherds, they will come together in a meeting place and mingle all their sheep together, and they will stay together for the night. The shepherds, by doing this, were teaching us the safety of being in the company of fellow believers. Who are your best friends, huh? Who? If you're a genuine Christian, there was a man several years back, and his pastor said, I was surprised when he said, my best friend is a Muslim. That doesn't mean you can't be a friend to them to show them Jesus. But we are not talking people that you consult with, that if anything happens to you, these are the people you call, you see. The people that are supposed to be in your inner circle are supposed to be like-minded people, believers like yourself, you see. So the shepherds, that was what they did. They're teaching us that. They were in their little group of fellow shepherds. The shepherds, as a camp of hard workers, were diligently watching over their sheep at night when they could be sleeping, you see, to keep the wolves at bay. It's not an easy job. All the afternoon, they've been grazing with their animals have been grazing. They had been moving from one place to another. And at night, they would want to sleep. But not these shepherds, no. They were up at night, keeping a vigil. Why? Because it's at night that wolves and other bad animals, they come to visit the sheep and they attack them. So they were watching when they could have been sleeping. This was to teach us the importance of working to the best of our ability on a daily job. As God called you to be a truck driver, you can drive that truck for Jesus and drive it to the best of your ability. Let your character represent Jesus on your driving as a truck driver. Are you a plumber, a dressmaker? You can, a homemaker, you can do all these things to the best of your ability, doing it for Jesus. The combination of walking with the right people and diligence in whatever we do is the recipe for positioning ourselves to receive divine secrets, you see. God can give you spiritual secrets about what is going on. He can give you occupational secret about something that is going to happen at your workplace. If you are diligent, if you're in the right circle, it can give you relational secrets. Maybe your boss at work or your friend or somebody, something is going on with them. You have to be careful about something. God will reveal the secret to you, you see. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33. 1 Corinthians 15:33. It says, do not be deceived. Evil company corrupt good habits. Period. That is very explanatory, isn't it? To walk with the right people is to walk with the right attitude. Let me back up and repeat that. If right now you don't do a bad job on the job, if you are working with somebody who likes to take shortcuts, I promise you, it's a matter of time. You will start to take shortcuts on the job too, because to work with the right people is to work with the right attitude. Where's your company, huh? Moving on. Decisive believers. These people were the shepherds. They were decisive believers. The shepherds were a league of open ears who did not get sidetracked by their job, but listened attentively to the message brought by the angel of the Lord. It reminds me of another character in the Bible, Onan the Jebusite. His story is in 1 Chronicles chapter 21. I mean, he's one character that is so, yeah, he makes me laugh. But even what he did wasn't a laughable thing. Really. Onan the Jebusite saw the angel of the Lord on his farm. His children, they became scared and they hid themselves. And the Bible says, Onan the Jebusite continued with his work, like the angel was not even there. But when Onan the Jebusite, or Arauna, that's another name that he went by, when he saw King David, guess what? He dropped what he was doing to go pay homage, to pay his respect to King David. You see, he feared a human being, but when he saw the angel of God, he couldn't be bothered, you see. But not these shepherds. When they saw the angel of the Lord, they became attentive. They were actively listening. With this attitude, the shepherds were teaching us the importance of being quiet in the spirit. It's very, very important, folks. Very, very important. Even as we work on our daily jobs, so we can hear the Holy Spirit. You see, I was mentoring somebody this afternoon, we were talking about the fruit of the Spirit, and I gave an example of a lady I met a few years back, and I said she talked all the right talk, she said all the right things. I said, but I noticed that she lacked the fruit of the Spirit of self-control. I mean, she will be talking. She can go do there for 3 hours, even if your body language was saying, I want to leave, you see. Well, not long after that, the Holy Spirit exposed this individual for who she really was, you see. So we need to learn to be quiet in the Spirit as believers, because something may want to happen on your job or where you are at that moment, and the Holy Spirit needs to tell you what's about to happen so you will know what to do. But if you are just why, hey, even if it's telling you, you don't have the ears to listen, you see. So the shepherds are teaching us to learn to shut down. Well, even as we go about our daily jobs. As a breed of decisive believers, the shepherds did not doubt what they had just been told by the angel. So they listened, and after they listened, they said, hey, listen, let's go. Let's go check this out. Where's the baby? Let's go. Let's go look for the baby. They believed as if they had already seen baby Jesus. They displayed a childlike faith, which is great in the sight of God. Watch this. This was teaching us how to trust God. The shepherds did not philosophize. They did not rationalize. They did not intellectualize the angel's message. Listen, many of us have got too many degrees, really, as far as spiritual things are concerned. It's time to lay that intellectual pride in the dust. Seriously. God will be teaching us or telling us, this is what I want you to do. And we put it in our peanut brains, saying, if I do it this way, it can't come out with that. Some will be using their scientific method. Excuse me, drop it down, okay? These people, they believed like a child. The angel said, go to the stable. And they said, let's go. That is what God is asking of us. The combination of a quiet spirit and a childlike faith is the recipe for experiencing, watch this, come on close, fulfillment of divine promises. You want God to fulfill his promises in your life? Huh? You want to see those things that you've been asking God for come to fulfillment? Learn to be quiet in your spirit so you can hear the Spirit speaking to you. If you are a child of God, if you are not, the Holy Spirit can't speak to you. The only thing the Holy Spirit will tell you is you need to change. You need to give your life to Jesus. And that can happen right here, right now. Just follow me, okay? But if you are a child of God, that you are already saved with the seal of the Holy Spirit in your heart, learn to be quiet and have childlike faith. Now, Jesus said, if we believe, we will see the glory of God. But faith is one area where a lot of believers have problems. I know what I went through when I first became born again, because I was coming from such a junky wilderness that so many things were in my brain, and the Lord had to be dealing with me one step at a time. So if you are having faith problem, this is what you do. Number one, you ask God for the grace to believe. You see, the Bible says 1 Corinthians 9:8 that God is able to make every grace abound toward us. Every grace. The grace for everything you need is in the Word of God. So ask God, Lord, give me the grace to believe. I want to believe. Give me the grace, and He will. The second thing you can do is turn to brothers and sisters in your fellowship, in your Bible group. Let them tell you their personal experiences from their faith walk with God. How God has proven Himself in their lives. How promises of God have been fulfilled in their lives. That will encourage your faith as well. That is, if you're having faith problem. So that's why I took my time on that, okay? Let's go to the gospel according to John chapter 4, verse 50. John 4, 50. And I'm using the New International Version. I like the way it's rendered there. Jesus speaking now to the centurion, he said, go, your son will live. The man took Jesus at his word and departed. I like that. He took Jesus at his word and departed. If you say, Josephine Zai, what Jesus promised me, if it doesn't happen, listen, you don't even have to worry about that. You know why? If that should happen, which can never, never happen. Listen, if Jesus should promise you something and he fails to fulfill it, you have no problem because you have no integrity to lose. Jesus has all the integrity to lose. And the Bible says he will never allow his faithfulness to fail. No, it's not going to happen. Sometimes, about this time last year, we were going through some stuff, and I remember I got angry at a point because I thought, there's no sin in my life that I know of, that I've not repented of, and I've prayed all the Bible passages I know. What is happening? Why is God not moving? Guess what? God had moved 2 months before I started praying. But I was not listening, you see. I didn't listen. God had already spoken about the situation I was praying for and agonizing over 2 months before it happened. But there I was, getting angry. And the Holy Spirit said, go back 2 months, go to where you write your prophecies. And when I saw it, I was just like, God, I'm sorry. Father, I'm sorry. You see, if anything goes wrong, it's never with God. He's with us, okay? So check yourself first and make sure you are in the right position with God, and you will see him come through for you. If you are full, you can't be filled. Let's say that again. It sounds so simple, but it's really heavy, spiritually speaking. If you are full of your way, of your own wisdom, of your way of doing things, of your own ideas, you can't be filled by the Holy Spirit. Forget it. Moving on. The shepherds were earnest seekers. The shepherds were a band of earnest seekers who acted on instruction as soon as the angels departed. You see, they didn't just listen. They didn't just believe. They acted. You see, they acted. They put legs on their faith. They did not delay. The shepherds are teaching us the importance of acting on our faith. The actions we take after we have received a divine instruction will show, watch this, if we indeed believed what God had told us or not. God told you he's going to give you a good job. And then you say, oh, praise God, hallelujah. But you have refused to intensify your search for jobs. Listen up now. Who is kidding who? Huh? That doesn't stop you from intensifying, telling everybody, I'm looking for a job. Go on the internet, send your CVs out, and the Lord will do that which he alone can do. You believe, but you act on your belief. That is faith. The shepherds didn't say, oh, we believe you, Lord. Yeah, baby Jesus is born. Beautiful. No. They said, now let's go. You see, as a union of good news carriers, the shepherds declared the great message which the angel of the Lord had declared to them. The shepherds, by doing this, are teaching us that our faith is not, underscore that, is not a silent faith. No. There's nothing like a secret Christian. Forget it. Forget it. We need to talk about Jesus. About just the things I am. I about my behavior, I can love them, that's good. But Jesus didn't say, go into all the world and love them. No, he said, go into all the world and preach this good news. That is love in action, you see. Because you can't preach to somebody about good news and be ugly in behavior to them. It's impossible, you see. So you really want to show love, you got to preach Jesus. If we indeed have faith in Jesus, we will talk about him. I'm telling you, I have to control myself a lot of times to not talk about my husband, you see. Why? Because I love my husband. It means so much to me. If you love Jesus, oh, listen. If Jesus is all you've got, you just want to be talking about him all day long, you see. The combination of putting our faith to action and declaring our faith in Jesus is the recipe of being useful for God and for experiencing greater blessings. You want to be useful for God? Put your faith into action and start talking about Jesus. Jesus said that he came to seek and save that which was lost. The Lord has equally tasked us to go into all the earth and preach this good news to to all nations, you see. Let's go to the gospel according to Luke, St. Luke chapter 7, verse 22. Luke 7, 22. Then Jesus answering said unto them, go your way and tell John what things ye have seen and heard, how that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, to the poor the gospel is preached. This was a very low point in the life of John the Baptist. He had been locked up by Herod for doing the right thing. And he was hoping that maybe something will happen. You know, I've been preaching about this Jesus, but what's going on? And John said to his disciples, go to this Jesus. Are you the Messiah, or we should wait for another? And Jesus answered with that response. And why did Jesus speak like that? Because the Old Testament, the law, and the prophet all said, prophesied that the Messiah would do these exact actions that Jesus spoke about. So Jesus was in a way speaking in code to John the Baptist, because he will understand that I am the Messiah, I'm fulfilling every old prophecy in the Bible, you see. And so they went and delivered that message to John. Listen, why the applications may be different, the principle is still the same. Who is the John in your family, in your neighborhood, in your workplace that have been locked up by the bad king? The bad king of drug addiction, the bad king of pornography, the bad king of sex addiction. Who is the person who has been locked up in prison? You need to let them know that through Jesus, the blind, the see, the deaf hear, the lame walk. And preach the gospel to such people who are in prison of sin. That is the only assignment that Jesus has given us as his body. All right? And that's exactly what the shepherds did. They declared the message when they got to the stable. To speak up about him is to stand up about him. If you speak up about him, you will stand up. It doesn't matter who is looking at you. To speak up about him is to stand up about him. What have we learned so far? What lessons can we learn from the shepherds? Number one, they were diligent watchers. We learn the safety of keeping the right company of fellow believers and of walking unto the Lord to the best of our ability. They were decisive believers. We learn to listen attentively to divine instructions and to believe God's word without doubting. They were earnest seekers. We learn to demonstrate our faith by obeying divine instructions and also to witness the gospel to others around us. So as a believer, are you unequally yoked with unbelievers? Huh? Who's your best friend? Who's your counselor? How is your attitude at work too? Do you go to your workplace and you act there like you are baptized in lime juice? Huh? They look at you, they don't want to come to church because of you. Is that who you are? Your company of friends and your character to others will go a long way to determine how greatly God can use you. If you have to change stuff around and repent, do that fast. You are to witness to unbelievers about Jesus. Loving unbelievers does not mean you are to agree with them in their state of unbelief. Oh no. Through mutual friendship. A lot of people, they will say, well, I'm trying to love them to Jesus, and they are carrying out their sinful behaviors around you, and you are quiet. No, you are tolerating sin. That is not right. That is not loving them. No. Your character should lead the way in your witnessing to them. When they behave badly with their sinful habits around you, you let them know that's not right. Nicely, that's not right. They'll be careful around you next time. That doesn't mean you can't help them on the job. If they need help, you can help them out. But when they do something that is not right, in a nice way, call them out. They'll be very careful around you, or they stop talking to you altogether. And they will respect you for who you are, your faith. Are you an unbeliever? Huh? You don't believe in Jesus? You're a pagan? You're unregenerate? Listen, that can change. I love what somebody said this evening. He said, everyone created by God as human beings, not the devil. He said, God predestined everybody to go to heaven. But people, they choose not to go to heaven. I was like, that was beautiful. You see, you may experience temporary happiness that life throws at you every now and then, but it never lasts. Am I right? Huh? If you want to experience the true, glorious joy of Christmas, which life's troubles cannot disturb, you have to come to Jesus, you see. Somebody said, without Christ, there's no Christmas. You can't write Christmas without Christ, you see. It's the joy of Christmas. You want that joy that won't be going up and down like a yo-yo, you need Jesus. You need to give him your heart, because he's the one who made your heart. The hole, the space that is there that you are trying to fill, only Jesus can fill it for you. Okay? And he wants to do that this Christmas. If you are ready, I'm going to say a quick prayer, and then a link is coming up. Follow that link. We'll meet you there, all right? Father, thank you because you are the joy of those who believe in you. Father, we ask that your joy will continue to strengthen us, to empower us to share the good news of the gospel with the pagans around us. And for those who are going to that website and to that web page where they will see further instructions on how to give their lives to Jesus, Father, let them know your joy, even as you open their eyes to the truth of the salvation of their souls through Jesus. Thank you, Father God. For in Jesus' name, I will pray. Amen and amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.